So, to look at the chemistry of these materials, you have to go back to the middle of the 19th century. There's a lot of work carried out in Germany to examine the organic chemistry of these materials, and that's to say how they're prepared, how they react, what sort of characteristics they have. And these materials then are the starting point for an industry which really starts to get going through the 20th century. So Rohm and Haase in 1911 start to examine these materials as potential commercial products. And as we get into the 1930s, suddenly there's an increase in interest in these materials. And so with competing interest from Rohm and Haase, from DuPont, and also later ICI, as the materials start to be developed as transparent, hard thermoplastic materials with really key interesting properties, not least the refractive index of the materials. They're highly transparent. They absorb very little visible light. So something like 92% of the incident light will be carried through the materials. And so suddenly there's a huge interest in developing these materials for the war effort. And so acrylics are used in the Spitfire, they're used in the Hurricane. And so there's a great upswell of interest in these materials. And then through the 30s into the 40s, the interest in the materials continues. The starting point for the use of acrylics in artists' materials comes around in the post-war 1940s. In this case, acrylics are suddenly being mooted as new materials with a very fast drying time. And so the ability to apply them to a number of different surfaces because they adhere very well. They're also quite flexible when you formulate them in a cross-linkable sort of form, so that you have a material which will gradually undergo oxidative cross-linking. So not only will it coalesce to form a film, but it's also gradually cross-linking to form a nice durable coating. The timing of the production of these materials starts to really coincide with an upswell interest in a variety of different forms of art. So pop art starts to become a big thing, and during the 40s, 50s and 60s, the new artists, people like Rothko or Lichtenstein, David Hockney, are using acrylics. And so what you see is a very different form of graphic depiction. So often very vibrant colours, very hard-edged presentation. People like Jackson Pollock. And so acrylics in that sense mean that you can begin to play with colour in a very different way. And so the gradual polymerization of these materials, which effectively undergo a reaction of this double bond in the monomer, the building block, to form a chain polymer and then gradually cross-linking with various cross-linkers, means that you have a material which will be forming a coating which is actually quite flexible as well, which means that you can get away with not being so concerned about cracking and brittleness. I mean, acrylics are now, you know, solidly part of the culture, and so whether you see humble modern-day artifacts or objects of high art and aesthetic beauty, they're very much part of what we see all around us. But the chemistry and indeed the science hasn't stopped.